Everyone, I am Dr. Kaminana Gautami. I am from Great Eastern Medical School and Hospital, Srikakulam. The title of my paper is Role of Conventional MRI with Functional Imaging in Preoperative Assessment of Cervical Carcinoma. My aims and objectives are to evaluate the role of conventional MRI in combination with functional MRI, that is the dynamic contrast imaging and the diffusion weighted imaging, in staging and diagnosis of cervical carcinoma and to facilitate patient stratification into treatment groups. Materials and methods for my study are, it's a prospective study carried on 10 patients having clinical signs and symptoms of uterine malignancy referred to the radio diagnosis department in Great Eastern Medical School and Hospital, and the imaging was done with 1.5 Tesla unit GE machine. Conventional MRI, contrast enhanced MRI and the diffusion weighted imagings were done. All cases staged with the aid of T2 weighted imagers and the dynamic contrast imagers and the diffusion weighted imaging. This is the case list with brief description of cases. These are the symptoms presented in the 10 patients in my study. They are postmenopausal bleeding, which is seen in 5 patients, offensive watery discharge seen in 3 patients, abnormal vaginal discharge seen in 2 patients. And the pathology showing the following MRI signal intensity in different sequences. In T1 weighted image showing the ISO intensity, and the T2 weighted images in 7 patients showing the high signal intensity, and in 3 patients shows the ISO signal intensity, and it shows the intermediate intensity in post contrast and restriction on diffusion weighted imaging. These are the images in the first case, who is presented with cervical carcinoma, depending upon the imaging findings, staged under stage 2B, and the A and B are the sagittal and the axial sections of T2 weighted images, and the C is the axial section of the T1 weighted images, which is showing a well-defined T1 isointense, T2 hyperintense mass lesion shown by an asterisk symbol noted in the cervix, involving the lower uterine segment and the surrounding parametrial tissues, which is shown by an arrow, and the air fluid or blood fluid levels are noted in the lower uterine and the cervical canal. In the same patient, T1 weighted post contrast images and the diffusion weighted images are taken, which are shown by D and E, showing an heterogeneous enhancement on post contrast and diffusion restriction on diffusion weighted images. This is the second case who is presented with cervical carcinoma, depending upon the radiological findings, staged under stage 3B. The A and B are the sagittal axial sections in T2 weighted images, showing a relatively well-defined T2 heterogeneously hyperintense lesion shown with the symbol of asterisk, with central necrotic areas measuring 6.1 into 4.9 into 4.7 centimeters noted, arising from the cervix, extending superiorly into the lower uterine segment and inferiorly into the upper one-third of vagina, laterally into the bilateral parametrium. The lesion shows loss of fat planes with the anterior wall of rectum and the posterior wall of urinary bladder. And this lesion is causing compression of the left distal ureter, which is shown with the help of arrow, causing the dilatation of the left renal pelvis, which is also shown with an arrow, and the ureter proximal to it. Imaging features suggestive of the cervical carcinoma, causing the obstructive uropathy. And in the same patient, post contrast T1 weighted images and the diffusion weighted images showing an heterogeneous enhancement on post contrast and diffusion restriction on DWI. This is the third case, staged under stage 4. A and C are the sagittal and axial T2 weighted images, and the B is the coronal T1 weighted images, showing an ill-defined mass lesion showing T1, T2 heterogeneously isointense signal noted, occupying the entire uterus, cervix extension up to the upper two-thirds of vagina and bilateral parametrial extension. Lesion causing T2 hyperintense fluid collection in the endometrial cavity of the upper uterine cavity. The lesion is seen extending into the bladder anteriorly and anterior wall of the rectum posteriorly. In the D is the axial, E is the coronal, and F is the sesital T2-weighted images of the cervical carcinoma of the same patient showing an evidence of T2 isointense tubular structures in the D and E with internal septations noted in the left adnexa, measuring which is suggestive of left hydrosalpinx shown with the help of arrow. The lesion is causing compression of the left distal ureter, which is shown with the help of arrowhead, causing dilatation of the left ureter proximal to it, causing obstructive uropathy. These are the post contrast T2 weighted images and the diffusion weighted images in the same case, showing an enlarged left parapelvic lymph node with diffusion restriction on DWI. This is the staging of the cervical carcinoma depending upon the involvement of the part. In the stage 1, it is limited to the cervix. In the stage 2, vaginal extension up to the upper 2/3, and there is maybe it is again divided into 2A, 2B. Only upper 2/3 of vagina included in 2A. If parametrium involved, then 2B. In the 3, it will involve the lower 1/3 of the vagina, which is 3A. If the pelvic sidewall is involved or hydronephrosis is there, then it is staged under 3B. And the stage 4 means bladder or rectum may get involved. And my study, the study showed that conventional MRI with DC-MRI, DWI improves the accuracy for preoperative evaluation of cervical carcinoma. And the biopsies were done and proven those are all cervical carcinoma, and they were staged correctly. The take-home points are functional MRI improves staging accuracy and tumor delineation, thus improves pre-surgical mapping and accordingly stratification of the best treatment options. This will decrease the expected morbidity from unnecessary procedures and accordingly increases the overall patient survival. These are my references. Thank you.